The next item of business is a debate on motion number 1788 in the name of Bruce Crawford on the timetable for the Scottish Government's draft budget 2017-18. Can I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons now, and I would say we have a little time in hand, so I will make allowances for interventions. I call on Bruce Crawford to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the Finance and Constitution Committee. 10 minutes, Mr Crawford, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is my maiden speech as the convener to the Finance and Constitution Committee. I can safely say, Presiding Officer, that it's been a steep learning curve over the past month. I also concede I hadn't anticipated spending quite so much time considering the timetable for the draft budget. There are two main areas in which I want to cover today on behalf of the committee, Presiding Officer. First, there's the immediate issue of the 2017-18 draft budget. And secondly, there are a number of issues arising from the new financial powers, which will have a significant impact on how we conduct our budget scrutiny this year and beyond. On this specific matter, the committee and the Cabinet Secretary for Finance have agreed to establish a budget process review group. The group's work will include examining the impact of these new powers. And I'm delighted that a number of senior public finance experts, including the Auditor General, have agreed to join the group. Along with the Cabinet Secretary, I welcomed the external experts before they began their work of the group at their first meeting last Thursday. The group has a huge challenge in considering the impact of the new powers and redesigning the budget process together with its timetable prior to the publication of the draft budget for 2018-19. Presiding Officer, in regard to the draft budget timetable for 2017-18, it may be helpful to the Parliament to provide some procedural context to the debate. Under the terms of the written agreement, the Scottish Government is required to consult with the Finance Committee on a revised timescale for the budget process if it believes it may not be able to publish the draft budget by the 20th of September. As a result, the Cabinet Secretary wrote to the committee on 23rd of June, indicating that his preferred option would be for the draft budget this year to be published after the UK Autumn Statement. As we know, the UK Autumn Statement will be published on the 23rd of November, and the Cabinet Secretary has indicated to the Finance Committee that he intends to publish the draft budget 3 weeks thereafter. That will take us to the week beginning the 12th of November. The committee recognises this is a challenging timescale, but emphasises that this is the least necessary in order to allow some evidence taken prior to the Christmas recess. The committee has sent the Cabinet Secretary a draft timetable for scrutiny of the draft budget 2017-18, which fully demonstrates this point. Presiding Officer, in order to fully understand the financial and fiscal context in which we are operating, the committee took evidence from the Fraser Andler Institute on their excellent, detailed and challenging report on Scotland's budget 2 weeks ago. And one of the main themes of that discussion was the potential impact of Brexit on the public finances at the same time as the new tax powers are being devolved. As the Fraser Andler Institute report points out, delivering these new powers in normal times would be challenging enough, but, and I quote, they are being delivered at a time of significant fiscal challenge and economic uncertainty. The Fraser Andler Institute report includes a number of hypothetical scenarios for the resource block grant arising from the Autumn Statement. If the UK government announces on the 23rd of November a further reduction compared to what was set out in March this year, the Scottish block grant could bear significant consequential effects. One of the report's scenarios is for a further cut to the resource block grant of around £200 million for 2017-18. And as the Institute's report points out, given the budgetary commitments the Scottish Government's already made, a further reduction to the block grant of £200 million implies that unprotected areas of spend could potentially experience a real terms cut of 2.2% between 2016-17 and 2017-18. The FAI report further points out that an added challenge is that in these areas, and I quote, have borne a significant share of the burden of fiscal consolidation since 2010-11. The committee therefore recognises that the Scottish Government faces significant challenges in preparing the draft budget where there's so much economic and fiscal uncertainty arising from Brexit. The committee also recognises that a number of subject committees have already begun their budget scrutiny in advance of the draft budget being published. This is an approach we and the previous Finance Committee have encouraged as part of a move towards more outcomes-based financial scrutiny. For example, I know the Education and Skills Committee have begun to scrutinise a number of public bodies within their remits. This work includes seeking information on these public bodies' performance against the outcomes expected of them by the Scottish Government. Now, while the committee supports a move towards a more flexible approach to financial security scrutiny, which may be carried out throughout the year, this should not be reviewed as a replacement for scrutiny of the government's actual spending proposals. The committee recognises, though, that this year is different given the unique set of circumstances that currently exist as a consequence of Brexit and the imminent devolution of further tax powers. The committee therefore sought to work with the Cabinet Secretary in considering what level of information could reasonably be provided to support scrutiny prior to the draft budget being published. The Cabinet Secretary informed the committee on 7 September that he would be willing to produce as much scenario planning information as possible. There followed an exchange of letters between the Cabinet Secretary and the Finance Committee. But let me make it clear to the Cabinet Secretary today, as we did in our letter on the 21st of September, the committee would find it unacceptable if he confirms that he's not prepared to publish any such information in advance of the draft budget being published. However, moving forward on a more positive note, it's also important to emphasise that the government has agreed that the arrangements for scrutiny of this year's budget process should not be viewed in any way as setting a precedent for future years. Part of the important work which the Budget Review Group will now do over the coming months is to examine the effectiveness of the scrutiny of the draft budget for 2017-18. Finally, Presiding Officer, I want to touch briefly on some of the very important complex issues which the Review Group will have to grapple with as a consequence of the operation of the fiscal framework. The Deputy Convener, I understand, will also address some of these issues in his closing speech. This process will be highly complex, and I am no expert. However, it is essential that colleagues across the Parliament are well aware of how the money which will be available to the Scottish Government is calculated each year. There are a number of elements to this process which are worth highlighting. The budget will increasingly depend, which is obvious from the settlement, on the money we raise through the devolved taxes as well as the block grant from Westminster. As the money which we raise ourselves increases, there will be a corresponding reduction in the size of the block grant. However, this will not necessarily be a zero-sum calculation, as the reduction of the block grant will be dependent on the impact of the relative performance of the UK and Scottish economies on tax receipts. If, for instance, the Scottish economy outperforms the UK, then the Scottish budget should benefit, but it will suffer if we underperform relatively against UK economic growth. The size of the annual Scottish budget will initially be based on forecasts, which will then be subject to a reconciliation process. The annual adjustment to the block grant will be based on forecasts prepared by the Office of Budget Responsibility, while the anticipated tax receipts will be based on forecasts prepared by the Scottish Fiscal Commission. That's quite a complex set of information that the review group, the Finance Committee, and indeed this Parliament will have to grapple with. It is the understanding of the interrelationship between these forecasts and the subsequent reconciliation process which will be one of the main challenges that face the Budget Review Group, in due course, this Finance Committee and this Parliament. And obviously, we wish them well. Now, Presiding Officer, These are challenging times, and it's essential that we redesign our process to ensure the Parliament can rise to meet the challenge. And I'm looking forward to hearing the contributions of the various members of the Finance Committee and others today in this important debate. And I look forward to hearing the response to my speech from the Cabinet Secretary. But in the meantime, Presiding Officer, I move the motion in my name on behalf of the Finance Committee.
Thank you, Mr. Crawford. I call Derek Mackay to speak for the Government. Cabinet Secretary, 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I welcome Bruce Crawford to his position as Convener of the Finance Committee. I very much agree with Mr. Crawford on the point around the joint approach that we're taking on the longer-term look at the budget approach within the Scottish Parliament in a partnership style. There is a strong record of cooperation between the Scottish Government and the Finance Committee, and as a former member of the committee, I'm looking forward to maintaining and indeed strengthening that relationship in this Parliament. We have a highly transparent approach to budget scrutiny that dates back to 1998, and which I believe provides much more satisfactory arrangements for holding the government to account than is the case at Westminster. As I've previously set out to the Finance Committee, even before the EU referendum result, there was already a strong reason for publishing the draft budget after the UK autumn budget statement, a legacy issue from the previous term that it required to be addressed. The referendum result has given rise to significant additional economic and financial uncertainty, a point that the Chancellor of the Exchequer emphasised just yesterday at his party conference speech. This week, the Chancellor has also warned us that we should expect that the UK economy is heading for a roller coaster ride over the coming 2 years or more during negotiations to leave the European Union. The uncertainty continues, and it won't be until the 23rd of November that we discover what all this really means for the content of the autumn statement and the accompanying economic forecasts set out by the Office for Budget Responsibility. Both could potentially impact on the overall spending power available to the Scottish Government, both positively and negatively, in terms of Barnett consequentials and the calculation of the block grant adjustment. It is also conceivable that the Chancellor could set out changes to tax policy, welfare and pay, all of which we would want to consider and respond to. Publishing our budget before the autumn statement, of course.
James Kelly.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking the intervention. In terms of the actual figures, you've got a £30 billion budget, and you heard Bruce Crawford say that the Fraser Valander Institute reckoned that the variable in terms of change could be in the region of £200 million, less than 1% of that budget. Would you agree that that's a reasonable assessment?
Well, I think this relates to really the point around uncertainty. And the reason it's called uncertainty is I'm uncertain as to what the Chancellor might do. And I don't think even the Chancellor has clarity as to what he might do, because he'll be relying on the OBR forecast that drives his decisions, and that in turn affects the Scottish budget. And I say again that publishing our budget before the autumn statement would also mean that forecasts of tax receipts here and at the rest of the UK level would need to rely on economic data published alongside the March 2016 UK budget. And we would have serious concerns over the validity of such data in light of the economic upheaval following the EU referendum outcome, also referenced in the letter. I'm afraid I don't have time. Also covered in the letter from the Finance Committee, saying that the resulting economic and fiscal uncertainty arising from the Brexit vote means that there is now an arguable case for delaying the publication of the draft budget until then. It therefore makes sense, in my view, to defer finalising and publishing our spending plans until we have the additional clarity that the autumn statement should bring. Having set out the factors that will influence the timing of the Scottish budget, Scottish Government's draft budget this year, I can today confirm my intention to publish the draft budget 17-18 on the 15th of December 2016. This is in line with the aim that I set out at the committee on the 7th of September, that I'm committed to producing a budget as quickly as possible after the Chancellor's autumn statement. and that we would work incredibly hard to produce a draft budget in those 3 weeks after the autumn statement. I'm acutely aware of the potential impact that this will have on budget scrutiny in the traditional sense, so I was heartened to read the convener's recognition that a number of committees have already adapted their approach to budget scrutiny ahead of any draft budget publication to ensure that effective scrutiny continues to take place. Back in 1999, when the written agreement was designed, the Scottish budget was almost entirely funded from the block grant from Westminster, and only around 10% of the budget was funded from taxation. The increased scale and complexity of fiscal responsibilities that the Scottish Parliament and Scottish Government is adopting is hugely significant.
Please sit down, Mr. Harvey, the Cabinet Secretary is not giving way.
Well, I'll make further progress then, I'll take an intervention. The changes over the next few years will take us to a position where over 50% of our budget will be funded directly from taxation. The arrival of these new powers necessitates a long overdue and absolutely essential reform of the budget process, as opposed to just further minor adjustments. So I welcome the work that's now being undertaken in that joint approach. I'm very supportive of the establishment of the joint working group to look at the budget process with that external advice. Now, it's important that to ensure that we develop a process that balances the time required for proportionate and effective parliamentary scrutiny with the need to ensure that the information being scrutinised is as accurate as possible and based on the most up-to-date forecast information. I reiterate my willingness to provide the committee with additional strategic information to assist committees in preparing for the autumn statement and the draft budget. On the 7th of September, I offered to provide further work and updated economic financial modelling, which could provide analysis that demonstrates the impact that changes in economic performance would have on the Scottish budget. I can go on further about the detail that the Finance Committee was requesting, but I certainly intend to honour the commitment made to the Finance Committee around providing further information. What I can't do is provide a draft spending plan and budget. That would be a draft budget, but I will hold true to what I promised the Finance Committee and happy to take an intervention.
Mr. Harvey.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. He knows very well that the committee looked at that letter from him at the beginning of September and said that what it amounted to was unacceptable. He also knows, before he gets to his feet today, that a majority of this Parliament have already formally recorded a request for him to put scenario planning information with indicative figures into the public domain by the end of the October recess. We could have pushed this to a vote. We could have sought dramatic headlines at the end of the day and a vote at 5 o'clock, but we've bent over backwards, I think the committee has, to give the Cabinet Secretary alternatives to producing a draft budget because we understand the difficulty he is in. Is he not going to say anything following the position that he offered at the beginning of September to go further than he's gone so far and allow Parliament to do its job in budget scrutiny?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, what I've said to the Chamber is that I will honour the commitment given to the Finance Committee around sharing as much information as I possibly can. But I can't produce a scenario plan that's a spending budget, a draft budget, without having all the information that will come from the Chancellor's autumn statement. And that point is recognised by the Finance Committee. So I will again say that I'll produce as much information as I possibly can, but I cannot produce a draft budget that would be credible because of the uncertainty that exists within the system. So I'll continue to work constructively with the Finance Committee and share as much as I can to give as much certainty as I can, but that doesn't mean we can produce a draft budget. That will come in a credible way through the channel that has been outlined via the Finance Committee draft timetable. And I hope that members will appreciate a very positive approach to try and share as much as I can to support scrutiny of the Parliament and welcome the fact that many committees are already undertaking pre-budget scrutiny. And I think that's a very helpful approach within the Parliament.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Call Murdo Fraser to open for the Conservatives. 5 minutes or thereabouts, Mr. Fraser.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I start by thanking the committee convener, Bruce Crawford, for setting out very fairly the committee's position in his opening speech. As someone who's been noted for his loyalty to the government, I do appreciate this has not been an easy job for him to perform personally, but the role of a committee convener is to represent the committee view, even where one might hold different personal opinions, as I know from my own experience. I listened with great interest to the Finance Secretary's response this afternoon. The Finance Secretary essentially had a choice when he came to the Chamber this afternoon. He could either listen to the will of Parliament as expressed in a number of signatures for Mr Harvey's motion, which are the majority of Parliament, and offer concessions and offer to meet Parliament and the Finance Committee halfway, or he could try to brazen it out. And I regret very much he decided to take the latter path in the debate this afternoon and decided to brazen it out. I listened very carefully to his response. And I think the key point we need to stress is that this is not actually an issue about the timing of the draft budget, because the Finance Committee is not calling for the Finance Secretary to publish his budget before December. Much as we would like the budget to be introduced in September, we entirely recognise the difficulties that would cause both the Scottish Government and the parliamentary process. What this debate is actually about is whether sufficient information can be provided by the Scottish Government prior to the publication of the budget to allow effective parliamentary scrutiny. And it's clear that neither I nor the other members of the Finance Committee from all different parties are satisfied with the Cabinet Secretary's response. And in a letter from the committee to the Cabinet Secretary of the 21st of September, language is used which may well be unprecedented in a communication of this sort. What this matter revolves around is the level of information that can be provided to subject committees prior to the budget being published. As Bruce Crawford reminded us, when the Cabinet Secretary came to the Finance Committee on the 7th of September, he said, in response to a question from Mr Harvey, "I am willing to provide as much scenario planning information as I can." But in his subsequent letter to the committee, the Finance Secretary declined the committee's request to publish indicative budget figures or scenarios at the level of individual portfolios or programmes in advance of the draft budget to assist scrutiny, stating that, "I think this would risk creating some confusion." The concern is that the Finance Secretary has now gone back on his word to the committee, and he is offering less to the committee than what he previously promised. This is what led the committee to write in the very strong terms that we have seen. Now, we've seen, as Patrick Harvey already referred to in this debate, all opposition members have signed up to a motion in Mr Harvey's name calling on the Scottish Government to do what the Finance Committee called the Government to do, to publish budget scenario planning information and illustrative figures before the end of the October recess. I would sincerely hope that the Cabinet Secretary, if he will not do so in the course of this debate, will reflect upon this, the stated view of the majority members of this Parliament, and hold true to his original promise to the Finance Committee. This is not merely an academic matter. Effective democracy requires appropriate parliamentary scrutiny of the actions of government, and nowhere is that more important than in relation to scrutiny of the draft budget. The OECD, in their best practice for budget transparency guidance, state that the government's draft budget should be submitted to Parliament far enough in advance to allow Parliament to review it properly. Now, our record as a Parliament in the past in this area has been excellent, indeed far better than Westminster. Last year, the introduction of the budget was delayed because of the outcome of the UK government's spending review was being awaited. At that time, we were told by the Scottish Government that this would be a one-off. It is therefore very disappointing that we're seeing budget scrutiny being truncated for a second year in a row. So I do not accept, if Mr Swinney wants to give me an intervention as the former Finance Secretary, I'll
Mr Swinney.
The point I'm simply making to Mr Fraser was the budget process is delayed this year for the same reason it was last year, and that's the delay to the UK autumn statement. So it's exactly the same reason. I don't know quite why Mr Fraser is working himself up into a lather about this particular point.
Mr Fraser.
Well, perhaps if Mr Swinney was still Finance Secretary, he'd be treating the Finance Committee with a bit more respect than his successor seems to be. The point, surely, is that the autumn statement is going to come at the same time every year. Are we going to get into a pattern of delaying the Scottish Government's budget on an annual basis? Clearly, that's not acceptable. What we are trying to do is find a compromise position that allows the committees of this Parliament to do their job properly, to give them the information they require to at least start their work on budget scrutiny, and they're unable to do that at the moment because of the lack of information being provided. Presiding Officer, I think it's worth looking, in terms of the question of risks to the Scottish Government's budget, at the advice given to the Finance Committee by its own adviser. His advice and his actual words was that the impact of the autumn statement on the overall Scottish Government's budget was likely to be, and I quote, "relatively minor." Those are the actual words he used. And he suggested elsewhere that the overall impact on the budget, as Mr Kelly said in the intervention, was unlikely to be higher than £200 million. In the context, of course...
The member's in his last minute.
I'm sorry, Mr Crawford. In the context of an underspend revealed in the latest Audit Scotland report of the government's consolidated accounts of double that figure, £400 million. Presiding officer, if I just bring my remarks to a close, there's a very simple way for the Scottish Government to resolve this issue to the satisfaction of Parliament, and that is for the Cabinet Secretary to keep his word to the Finance Committee. He needs to provide enough information to Parliament and to the subject committees to allow them to do effective and proper scrutiny work. To do otherwise, frankly, is to show contempt both for the work of this Parliament and for the work of the Finance Committee. I'm pleased to support Mr Crawford's motion.
Thank you. I call Kezia Dugdale, open for the Labour Party. Ms Dugdale, 5 minutes or thereabouts.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The most important responsibility this Parliament has is to set a budget. This determines how much money is available to spend on the NHS, the most precious institution in this country. The budget allocates funding for nurseries, schools, colleges and universities, the institutions that will give our young people the skills they need to compete for the jobs of the future and indeed to grow our economy. And it decides how much money our councils receive, which has major consequences for the funding of vital local services like social care. In an age of austerity, a government's budget requires even more scrutiny than ever before, not less. Yet less scrutiny is exactly what the SNP are attempting to deliver here. Derek Mackay's decision not to publish the draft budget until December will severely limit the ability of the Parliament's committees to scrutinise the budget properly. In addition, by refusing to publish as much information as possible in advance of the publication of the draft budget later this year, Derek Mackay is treating this Parliament with contempt, particularly since he is going back on a promise that he has previously made to this Parliament. The late publication of the Chancellor's autumn statement has consequences for the budget. Of course it does. But it isn't sufficient justification for Derek Mackay's refusal to publish indicative figures and budget scenario planning information. In response to an earlier intervention, the Minister did suggest that we were looking for absolute figures. Of course, we recognise that that's unreasonable, but what we're asking for is indicative figures, the ability to look at different scenarios. That's all that we're calling for today. And as the Finance Committee confirmed, the consequentials from last year's autumn statement impacted just 0.5% of the Scottish Bloc grant. And given the cuts that we face, that's not an insignificant amount of money. But it cannot be used as an excuse for avoiding scrutiny of the government's spending decisions. We are only having this debate this afternoon because the convener of the Finance Committee, a member of the governing party, rightly would not accept the Finance Minister's attempt to avoid parliamentary scrutiny as much as possible. And to quote Bruce Crawford, it is unacceptable that the Finance Minister is not prepared to publish any such scenario planning information in advance of the draft budget. So I'm pleased to support Patrick Harvey's motion, which urges the government to come forward with its budget scenario plans before the October recess. And I've yet to hear anything from the Cabinet Secretary in response to Patrick Harvey's intervention as to whether that clarity will be provided. This motion, at the last count, has received the support of the majority of MSPs across the chamber. And can I say to the Cabinet Secretary, there is an irony about the two debates we're having this afternoon. We support the government's efforts when it comes to debating the impact of Brexit on Scotland's economy. We've lent the First Minister our support to do that. And each time we have a vote in this chamber on an issue like higher education, the First Minister takes that message out of this Parliament and goes to other European countries and presents it as the will of this Parliament. So how can it be that the First Minister can rely on the will of the Parliament beyond it, but not listen to the will of the Parliament whilst we are in it? And I would ask Mr Mackay to reflect on the seriousness of that particular motion that's been put forward today. This Parliament must hold the government to account for the budget that it seeks to pass, and the Labour Party will certainly do that. So here are three very specific questions for the Finance Secretary. Will he commit to producing a three-year spending review so that public services and all organisations dependent on government funding can plan ahead? Will he guarantee that next year's draft budget bill will revert back to being published in September, as in previous years? And will he support Labour's calls for the Scottish Fiscal Commission to independently scrutinise all Scottish government accounts, including spending commitments? Presiding Officer, the Labour Party will not vote for any budget that meekly passes on cuts, or even doubles down on it, as is the case with local government. The First Minister promised voters she would be an anti-austerity champion. Instead, she has become an administrator for that austerity. So when the Scottish Government presents the budget to Parliament, Labour will place amendments to introduce a 50p tax on those earning over £150,000 to invest in our schools and nurseries. And we will also seek to add a penny to income tax to pay for public services. Making decisions for Scotland that the Tories would never make and using the powers which we have all argued for this place. This, together with our other tax proposals, will enable us to stop further cuts to the public services that we all rely on. With the full range of powers the Scottish Parliament now has, the SNP Government faces a clear choice. Accept a Tory budget from Westminster or go our own way with proposals to grow the Scottish economy and protect our schools and hospitals. More and more cuts to Scotland's budget harms our country's growth, risks jobs and prospects for our young people. We need to invest to provide the next generation of Scots with the chances they need to succeed. If the SNP minority government does not accept these proposals and forces another austerity budget on Holyrood, we, the Labour Party, will vote against it. If they want support, they'll need to look to the Tories for that. Labour will not and cannot help the SNP pass an austerity budget. Thank you.
I say to the member, I did give her a bit of leeway on that because it was about the scheduling and timetabling, but I expect the debate might wander a little, but keep a lookout not to wander too far from the topic in hand. I now go to the open debate. It's 4 minute speeches or thereabouts, so I give room for interventions. Kate Forbes, followed by Graeme Simpson. Ms. Forbes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, judging by the Conservative Party conference yesterday, we're all in for a treat as Mr. Hammond takes us for a roller coaster ride. He and Ms. May are, after all, stationed at the controls. While she promises to push the button on Article 50, he's ready to reset the economy in the autumn statement. This is not a normal year, and so I think we're all agreed that it cannot be a normal budget process. New fiscal powers introduce greater risk and reward to the Scottish budget at a time of economic uncertainty following the referendum and unknown plans at the hands of a new UK Chancellor. Yes, there are some clues. The Fraser-Vallander Institute suggested that a weaker economic outlook and rising inflation means that the Chancellor is even more likely to cut the Scottish budget by up to 6% perhaps by 2020-21. But these are clues. And unless Mr. Hammond chooses to enlighten us now with one stroke of the pen or one word in person, we're dealing in clues until his autumn statement on the 23rd of November.
Mr. Tompkins.
Given that she quotes the Fraser-Vallander Institute, I wonder if she would also agree with the Fraser-Vallander Institute when they say that the role of Parliament and indeed of Civic Scotland in scrutinising and influencing budgetary plans should be strengthened and not weakened.
Precisely, I would agree with that, but I would also say that scrutiny should not be judged solely in weeks, but by the focused attention to the budget, and the Cabinet Secretary has today already said that he will assist in that process as much as possible by providing modelling and as much information in advance of the budget. For this government to publish detailed numbers or scenario plans, which are essentially the budget, in advance of the autumn statement, when Scotland's relative performance is more important than ever before, at a time of economic uncertainty and entirely in the dark about the UK government spending plan, wouldn't just be unwise, it would be downright irresponsible. And this Cabinet Secretary has a responsibility to the people of Scotland to manage our finances with prudence and reason, which I think is precisely what he's doing. I am fully in agreement with those, like Mr. Tompkins, who argue that scrutiny is more critical than ever. And I don't underestimate the time pressures on the finance and subject committees. I'm a member of one. So to ask members like me to scrutinise numbers we know are incorrect and then to do it all again when we've got the right ones is not effective scrutiny nor a good use of parliamentary time. As I've just said, scrutiny should not be measured solely by weeks, but by effectiveness. And it must certainly be based on highly accurate and up-to-date forecasts. Now, I'm not one to quote the Tories, whose own Chancellor said yesterday that when times change, we must change with them. And it's to the credit of members in this Parliament that every subject committee has already adapted its approach to budget scrutiny, be it through high-level pre-budget scrutiny or extra committee sessions. It's happening already. This is not a normal year. This cannot be a normal budget process. Our budget timetable was designed nearly two decades ago, and the original principles of the Financial Issues Advisory Group should underpin the budget process every year. But how we apply those principles must adapt to the changing economic and political climate. This Parliament is noted for its adaptability to change and its scrutiny of the government's budget, in sharp contrast to Westminster. We have the opportunity to do both, to refocus our efforts by adapting our timescale for more effective scrutiny. And I think there's a responsibility in all of us, to the people of Scotland, to get on and to do that. Thank you.
Thank you. Paul Graham Simpson, to be followed by James Kelly. Mr. Simpson.
Thank you. This Parliament's been criticised in the past for its poor standard of scrutiny. Certainly before the current sitting, it was lacking. Governments don't tend to like scrutiny. Well, this one certainly doesn't. It's absolutely vital that laws and budgets are put through the ringer so that we end up with better legislation and better spending plans. To do that, MSPs need to have adequate time in which to carry out our vital role. For Derek Mackay to give the subject committees 2 weeks, in which to scrutinise his draft budget is frankly ridiculous and unacceptable. And we can see how Parliament feels by the strength of support for Patrick Harvey's well-crafted motion. Derek Mackay had an opportunity today to give concessions. He's chosen not to take it, and that's disappointing. It must have pained Bruce Crawford to write the letter that he did to the Cabinet Secretary. Mr. Crawford clearly takes his role seriously, and he's to be commended for acting the way he did. Derek Mackay can bleat all he likes about the timing of the autumn statement, but it's a pathetic excuse. As the advisor to the Finance Committee, absolutely.
Cabinet Secretary.
So what does Mr. Simpson make of the Northern Ireland executive delaying their budget until after the Chancellor's autumn statement?
Mr. Simpson.
Yes, and the Welsh Assembly haven't. And you are the Finance Secretary of Scotland. So let us deal with Scotland, Mr. Mackay. Let us deal with your responsibility to this Parliament.
Here, here.
As the advisor to the Finance Committee stated, if you had published the draft budget prior to the open statement, any changes afterwards would likely be relatively minor and marginal. You are the Finance Secretary of Scotland in your answer answerable to Parliament. No. Mr. Mackay owes it to us as members of committees to allow us to do our job effectively. He's a former council leader. He should know that people need time to consider things like budgets. They also need a heads up on what is likely to happen. It was quite reasonable for the Finance Committee to ask for scenario planning information. Mr. Mackay initially said he'd help and then performed a screeching U-turn. I say this to Derek Mackay, you're not there to be a roadblock. You're there to help smooth the way. I once had high hopes for Derek Mackay, particularly when, as a council leader, he agreed to speak to a meeting of Conservative councillors at my invitation. But those high hopes are dwindling. It comes to something when an SNP committee convener tells a government minister of his own party that his behaviour is unacceptable. Derek Mackay would do well to heed the words of Bruce Crawford. He should reflect on the matter. And when he has, he should conclude that, as I said at the start, proper scrutiny is essential. 2 weeks doesn't allow for that. Scotland used to be one of the world leaders when it came to the time allocated for budget scrutiny, second only to the US. Derek Mackay is taking us to the bottom of the pile, and that is simply not good enough.
Thank you. I call James Kelly, be followed by Patrick Harvey. Mr. Kelly, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I must say I found Derek Mackay's response very disappointing. This is a serious debate about how best Parliament can scrutinise the budget. The committee had reasonable discussions with him. Mr. Harvey again offered them a reasonable way forward. And to be honest, what we got was 7 minutes of absolute waffle. The bottom line in this is that we have a £30 billion budget to consider, and the Finance Committee were looking for scenario planning. And what that really involves is that you have an optimistic scenario, a middle scenario, and a pessimistic scenario. So you produce one scenario at 29.6 billion, one at 30 billion, and one at 30.4 billion, and you run all the high-level figures through. And it's disingenuous of Mr. Mackay, you know, to try and pretend how difficult it is. Don't forget, a lot of this information is already in place. The government budget holders, you know, they don't sit with a blank piece of paper each year when it comes round to the budget. They go back to the previous year's budget and they start with that. And don't forget that in terms of the Scottish budget, 55% of the budget is made up of staff costs. They aren't going to vary a great deal year to year, and there are other fixed costs. We heard in the programme for government, the government make a number of spending commitments which will roll over into the budget. So there's no excuse for not being able to produce different scenarios with high-level indicative figures. When we discussed the matter at the committee, I actually favoured publication of the budget along the normal timetable. I wasn't convinced by the Cabinet Secretary's arguments. However, the committee, you know, very reasonably gave Mr. Mackay a way forward and asked for scenario planning and indicative figures. And Mr. Mackay at the meeting gave the committee the impression that he was prepared to go along with that and to provide that solution. It therefore came as something of a shock, you know, and a slap in the face to the committee when Mr. Mackay wrote to the committee basically refusing to provide that information. And I think, you know, where that leaves us now is that it leaves us in a position where we're not able to carry out proper scrutiny. I mean, how can the subject committees in a matter of 2 weeks, you know, properly scrutinise the budget? You know, that really weakens and undermines the process. And the irony in all this is that this comes at a time, this is the most important budget in the history of the Scottish Parliament. We have more powers at our disposal than ever before. But at this time, Derek Mackay is seeking to curtail and to close down the debate. Never more than any time before should we be opening the budget process up for scrutiny, for looking for ideas and involving more people. And it's difficult to do that when you reduce the timescale. I say once again that Mr. Harvey's motion, which has got the support of the majority of Parliament, gives Mr. Mackay a way forward. And he should seriously reflect before he stands up to respond. Because if he doesn't respond positively and look to address some of the issues in Patrick Harvey's motion, then he will be seen, and his government will be seen, with treating Parliament with contempt.
Thank you. Call Patrick Harvey to be followed by Willie Rennie. Mr. Harvey.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I'm grateful that the smaller parties have a chance to participate in what is a relatively short debate. But it's a debate that I thought was important for us to have. I argued in the Finance Committee that this debate should be brought to the Chamber. And I want to pay tribute not only to Bruce Crawford and the way in which he chaired that committee seeking consensus, and that wasn't easy, and I recognise that, but also to recognise the difficult position that Mr. Mackay himself is in and that the Scottish Government is in. I don't pretend that this is easy, not for a moment, but it was important as well to recognise that the opposition parties could have insisted, instead of a committee debate with a motion saying that we should have a debate about the timetable, we could have insisted on a substantive debate with motions and amendments and votes at decision time. We didn't do that. We could have insisted in agreeing a letter demanding a draft budget be published in October as one of the earlier proposed timetables set out. We didn't do that either. At every stage, we've sought to give the Cabinet Secretary an incentive but also an opportunity to bring forward a budget process which is up to the job. The letter that Mr. Mackay referred to earlier, telling us what he was able to talk about, largely indicated that he was willing to expand on information that's already in the public domain or set out some of the choices that the UK government might make. Well, we can all speculate about that, just as the Fraser of Allender can. But what we need, and what our subject committees need, is the ability to consider the choices the Scottish government will make in response and how that will impact on many of the things that we all care about. Look, there are things that we're anticipating in the budget when it's proposed that I'll disagree with and things that I'll agree with. I want to see, you know, radical investment in much greater childcare in Scotland. I want to see the investment that's been needed for so long in a national infrastructure priority for energy efficiency. Now, I want to know, as our subject committees are meeting, taking evidence ahead of the draft budget, I want to know whether those things are under threat, what the impact will be if the Scottish Government's budget is indeed cut. Or others might be concerned to know whether the Scottish Government's existing tax plans will have to change as a result of that, whether on income tax, on air passenger duty, or indeed at a local level. And then again, local councils and other public bodies around Scotland are trying to make their plans right now. They're trying to look ahead, and they're all having to do that under the assumption of the worst-case scenario because there is nothing else out there. I want to express gratitude to the members who've added their names to the motion that I lodged. And again, I reinforce to SNP colleagues, I have deliberately brought a motion to express the support of members who share this view, not to force a vote on it, but to give the Cabinet Secretary the opportunity, and I hope he takes this opportunity in his closing speech, actually to give us more information about what he's going to put into the public domain.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think I tried to express in my opening remarks a willingness to continue to work with the Finance Committee to share as much information as possible, and that continues. And I hear the request for scenario planning, and there has to be room for agreement around something short of a budget, which members have said they don't expect, but enough information to allow fuller scrutiny. And I say this genuinely to Patrick Harvey. I do think there's room for an agreement around this, and I'll continue to work on it, listening to the voices in Parliament.
Mr. Harvey.
Well, I agree that there's room for agreement, and I agree that we have to accept something short of a budget, but that's what we were discussing a month ago. That's what we were discussing a month ago at committee on the record when the Cabinet Secretary told us, I am willing to produce as much scenario planning information as I can. And it's after that that commitment has been withdrawn and the committee has agreed that's an unacceptable position. Look, Deputy Presiding Officer, I know that we're short of time. I do want to express respect and understanding for the position that the government is in. And we do have to acknowledge, regrettably, that something short of a draft budget is going to be necessary. But we do need more detail, and I would like to hear a commitment from Mr. Mackay in his closing speech that he will accept the will of the majority of Parliament and publish that scenario planning information with illustrative figures by the end of the October recess. That is what Parliament has asked for, and I think that not only MSPs, but all of the people that we serve and the organisations whose livelihoods and whose work and whose public service depends on the public spending plans that the government's going to bring forward, I think we all have a right to expect that.
Thank you. I call Willie Rennie, followed by James Dornan. Mr. Rennie.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I've always thought Bruce Crawford was a very wise, sensible, reasonable man, and that was confirmed this afternoon, and I see him squirming in his chair as I give him that recommendation. But I think it does come to something when somebody of Bruce Crawford's stature is prepared to put forward such a powerful case and use phrases such as unacceptable behaviour. I think that is something that the Minister should pay heed to. We all accept that the circumstances have changed with the new powers and welfare and tax, plus the autumn statement, Brexit, we all accept that. But I think that makes the case for more scrutiny, not less scrutiny. It makes the case for having a more detailed discussion with the country, not less. Of course we understand they can't produce a draft budget with all those variables in place, but let's understand a bit more of the detail. I mean, after all, the SNP government is expert on everybody else's responsibilities. I mean, we've projected, apparently, for the next 20 years, the cost of Brexit, but we can't predict the budget just a few weeks ahead. We need to have a bit more perspective and understanding. I mean, Fraser of Allender, which the minister has repeatedly quoted their report, repeatedly done so, they have made some projections over 5 years. Now, they must have some credibility if the minister spends quite a bit of his time giving credit to that report, but seems incapable of using with all the might and the resource of the Scottish Government to produce anything in comparison with the Fraser of Allender report itself. So I think it would be helpful if the minister paid heed to what has been recommended today on scenario planning with indicative figures by the October recess. I think that's a reasonable thing to do, and I think I've seen a bit of movement from the minister today. I hope it certainly is a bit of movement towards that position so that we can have greater scrutiny and debate. Because actually, I think the hesitation, the resistance that is clear from the minister, I fear is an indication of an uncertainty about their manifesto commitment. Some of the things that were worked out months ago in advance of the election, things like the spending on health, the £500 million extra on health, what does that actually mean in terms of the headline budget, in terms of police spending, the real terms increases in police spending? What does that actually mean for the final budget? The childcare commitment, one of the biggest and boldest commitments, I think, of this government. I would like to see some profiling on that too, to see if we can really test whether some of the predictions that have been made about the rollout of that can come true. But also on air passenger duty, what is the real price of that cut? And finally, one of the biggest things that Fraser of Allender have pointed out is what are the protected departments and what are the unprotected departments in some detail, so we can fully understand what the implications for those unprotected departments will be. Because the First Minister has made it clear on a number of occasions that Fraser of Allender report, she quotes at question time in this Parliament, that the cuts could be something like £1.6 billion. Well, I think we need to see some of the detail of what that could mean for those unprotected departments before we get to the final publication of the budget. That's some of the detail I think that this Parliament deserves to see. I hope we have seen some movement from the Minister today. I hope that he pays heed to the wise words of Bruce Crawford so that we can come to some acceptable compromise on this, so it's no longer unacceptable in the eyes of the committee. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now call on James Dornan. Well, last speak in the open debate when we move to winding up speeches. Mr Dornan, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Before I make some comments about the role of the Education Skills Committee, I would like to comment on one or two things that have been said earlier on. I take on board Patrick Harvey's comments about, you know, we could have went another way, and I also take on board the sincerity of why he went this way. I look at some of the politicians from the other parties and see people playing political games with this. This is Kezia Dugdale. She gave us some of her top lines from her failed manifesto. Graham Simpson used it to attack the Parliament and then praise the Parliament for the exact same things he'd attacked him on just prior to that. And we get Willie Rennie scaremongering about the consequences of the SNP's manifesto commitments. That's not what this should be about. My colleague Kate Forbes made a very good contribution, and then she was talking about effective scrutiny not being about time, not being about weeks, but about being about the quality of it. And she's quite right. How can we possibly scrutinise something when we don't know how much money we've got to spend? Surely it's more important that we have the budget there and then we can scrutinise that closely. And if it means that we have to work longer or work more often and as a committee, then that's what we have to do. Now, we've already said that Bruce Crawford very kindly talked about the Education and Skills Committee having done work in the pre-budget scrutiny. And it's quite clear that we're not alone in this. We've agreed to undertake this scrutiny in the performance of four public bodies this autumn. them prior to the expected publication of the budget. The bodies of Skill Development Scotland, Scottish Funding Council, SQA and Education Scotland. We've recently written to all these bodies asking them to set out performance and delivering outcomes, how outcomes are measured, how they have adopted the Christie principles of reform and how their work contributes to the Scottish Government's climate change target. We expect a response by the 14th of October and we'll be hearing from the bodies in November. Now, that's all stuff that we can be doing in the run-up to the budget coming out from the Cabinet Secretary. Our work has fallen on from the work of our predecessor committee, which looked at the same bodies last year. It's also influenced by the Finance Committee's guidance to subject committees issued at the beginning of the summer. So this is not something that, you know, we just popped out our head when we were thinking, what can we do? What can we do while we're waiting on the budget? The purpose is to hold these bodies to account for their spending and strategic decisions and to help ensure that their continuing performance is of the highest quality. The committee is keen to get a good understanding of how these bodies have delivered outcomes and positively affected the lives of people of Scotland. And looking back on this, we also put the committee in a good position to evaluate future spending decisions. And as well as writing to the bodies involved, I've written to a number of stakeholders and experts seeking their views on how the four public bodies perform. It's also important to hear from the people who deliver and use public services. We will, of course, accept relevant submissions from anyone, and in order to help ensure that everyone is able to speak freely, we've agreed to publish submissions anonymously if an individual asks us to do so. And along with my colleague Ross Greer from Patrick Harvey's party, the Greens, I'll be speaking to teachers here in the Parliament tomorrow about their direct experience of these bodies and the impact the organisations have on teachers themselves, their schools and the outcome for their pupils. The committee will soon publish a short survey, again with a focus on how the bodies deliver on outcomes. Members of the committee also plan to undertake a number of visits to get a real feel for the work of these organisations. The purpose of the engagement work is to get a well-rounded understanding of the public bodies and their work, which will support the committee's scrutiny. We want to include as many people as we can in the process. And let me make it clear here, on the committee, there are two Labour members, there are two Conservative members, there's one Green member and there's one Lib Dem member. They've all signed up to this pre-budget scrutiny. They all see this as the way forward. They've all accepted the timetable as has been put forward in front of us. And for me, that's what highlights here, that this is not about the very important issue of the scrutiny of the budget, which we have to accept is out of our hands, because if it wasn't for the Brexit vote and for this autumn statement that's going to be coming, which could have a devastating impact on the Scottish budget, then we wouldn't be in this situation in the first place. So the Cabinet Secretary has said that he will work closely with the Finance Committee. Let's hold him to his word on that. But at the end of the day, let's support him in doing so. Thank you.
We now move to the closing speeches, and I call on Alex Rowley. Around 4 minutes, please, Mr. Rowley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today's debate has been fairly consensual in that there is an acceptance that the government is not in full control of the situation in terms of the UK government's autumn statement. But I would have to say that when I looked at the papers last night, looked at what the Finance Committee were saying and what Bruce Crawford was saying, I did think that today we would be able to reach consensus in terms of being able to provide as much information as possible. And that's a point I'll come back to. The OECD principles of budgetary governance states that a national parliament has a fundamental role in authorising budget decisions and in holding governments to account. They state and go on and say that government should provide for an inclusive, participative and realistic debate on budget choices by offering opportunities for Parliament and its committees to engage within the budget process at all key stages of the budget cycle. And I think that is the concern that has been raised by all parties in here today, is that we're not going to be able to do that with this year's budget. And clearly we were not able to do that and achieve those principles in last year's budget. Now, the Spice, who wrote a paper for in terms of budgets, said that overall their paper at least says that the Scottish process, when measured against most of the criteria that was set out, is relatively favourable. Scotland is in line with best practice when it comes to the time allocated for budget scrutiny. The committee structure in place for dealing with the budgets and the involvement of the Finance Committee in ordinary legislation. So Scotland is also better placed than many legislators in that it has some capacity for obtaining expert advice and research on financial matters. So in general terms, our Parliament would be up there amongst the best, but given what's happened over the last 2 years, then we are not. Nobody in here today, I think, has suggested that's the fault of the Scottish Government and that clearly the autumn statement. But that raises a couple of questions. Bruce Crawford, I think, did talk about a budget process review group, and that review group will be looking, given what's happened over the last 2 years, and the Minister might want to say something more about that, so that, to Kezia Dugdale's point, that when we come to next year, we don't want to find ourselves in this same situation. And I hope it also picks up the point that Kezia Dugdale made in terms of a three-year budget cycle, something that most of the rest of government, local government, the third sector, are calling for. But I'm a bit lost, because the Minister, when he went to the Finance Committee on the 7th of September, Derek Mackay, and I quote, "I'm willing to produce as much scenario planning information as I can." And the question is, what's changed? Because then he goes on to tell the committee that he will not be publishing any such scenario planning in advance of the draft budget. So the question there, and I think the legitimate question that people are asking, what changed? Some have suggested that he went back and his officials told him that would be too difficult. But we need to know what's changed, and that is all the committee are really asking for. In my final few minutes, can I say that yesterday I met with a group of local government leaders right across Scotland who are agonising right now, looking at their budgets and looking at where the cuts are going to have to take place. And one of them said to me, well, we've been told by Derek Mackay that things are likely to get much worse in the coming years. You know, given that we're talking about real people here depending on public services, this situation is not satisfactory. And I think that's all that the parties are asking today.
Too far on.
Not
you,
to
Mr.
go
Donald.
Back on your word. You told the committee you would look at scenario planning and bring forward that information. I would urge the Minister today, let's do that.
I call on Adam Tompkins. Around 4 minutes, please, Mr.
Thank Donald. You, Deputy Presiding Officer. We are a parliamentary democracy. We do not elect our government directly. Government emerges out of Parliament and is accountable to Parliament and not the other way around. Effective, robust parliamentary scrutiny is the very lifeblood of our democracy. So any attempt to dilute that effectiveness, to undermine this Parliament's ability to do its job of holding the government of the day to account for its policies, decisions and actions, should therefore be tested against the highest standards, and if they are found wanting, resisted. And the Cabinet Secretary's proposals not to publish until the middle of December manifestly fail this test. The current Finance Secretary first brought his proposal to the Finance Committee in June. On that occasion, his excuses for seeking the evisceration of effective parliamentary scrutiny included that this Parliament, in comparison with its predecessors, has increased spending powers, particularly as regards social security. But as those responsibilities are for later years in this Parliament and not for the current budget cycle, it was obvious that the Cabinet Secretary was pulling a fast one, or, if that's not parliamentary language, Deputy Presiding Officer, pulling the wool over the eyes of the Finance Committee. As the committee has said in its letter to Mr. Mackay of the 21st of September, we did not consider that the reasons as set out in June would have been sufficient to justify delaying the publication of the draft budget. It was only much later, and in some evident desperation, that the Finance Secretary turned to the SNP's favourite excuse for inaction, Brexit, as the all-too-convenient hook on which to hang his shugly Absolutely. Plans. Absolutely. Well, Presiding Officer, I don't believe a word of it. What I do believe is the advice of the Finance Committee's independent advisor, that the effects of the UK government's fiscal decisions on the Scottish government's budget are likely to be minor, marginal, and limited. And when contrasted, absolutely.
Bruce Crawford.
On a number of occasions, a number of members have raised that specific point, Mr. Tompkins, but we also accept that following the Fraser-Valander Institute report, actually the committee advisor's report perspective changed a bit as a result of that particular report.
The
margin that we're talking about, as James Kelly and others have pointed out repeatedly through this debate, is a margin of about £200 million in a budget of more than £30 billion. That is relatively minor in comparison with the devastating impact on effective parliamentary scrutiny that Derek Mackay's proposals will have. And when you consider the relationship between the marginal impact that the UK's autumn statement is likely to have on the Scottish Government's budget against the significant impact on effective parliamentary scrutiny that his proposals will have, it is obvious, Deputy Presiding Officer, where the balance of public interest lies. The Cabinet Secretary's plans are disproportionate, they are unnecessary, they are profoundly disrespectful of this Parliament's authority, and frankly, they are unworthy of him. As Audit Scotland have said, effective parliamentary scrutiny is critical to ensure that decisions being taken by government are thoroughly tested and independently reviewed. As they go on to say, it is necessary for us to see a step change in budget scrutiny. Well, this is a step change in budget scrutiny, but it's not quite the direction of the step change that Audit Scotland had in mind, is it? These proposals, frankly, are unworthy of this Cabinet Secretary, and they should, Deputy Presiding Officer, be resisted. Yeah.
I call on Derek Mackay, around 6 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I actually thought that this afternoon's debate was helpful and constructive and very useful. Adam Tompkins, of course, can't help himself but add a bit of colour to the debate, some of which I would challenge around the budget that we face and the Chancellor's autumn statement being marginal. That's not the impression I get from the Chancellor or the Chief Secretary to the Treasury, who's spoken about resetting fiscal policy, about economic turbulence. And of course, this Tory Chancellor's abandoned the economic policies of the previous Tory Chancellor, who he has replaced. And there is a great deal of economic consensus that the decision and the vote around Brexit will have a profound impact on the UK economy. And of course, the Scottish economy, thanks to the Tories playing party games, look at the mess they've left the UK economy in. So there will have to be a response to that. But there was wise advice left to the Scottish Parliament from the previous Finance Committee to address those legacy issues about wise use of forecasts and making decisions as close to those forecasts as possible. So I think that information is helpful, and that's why I immediately embarked upon the transformation of our scrutiny processes to recognise the powers that we have, the increased complexity, and the role that Parliament should have, which of course should be respected. That's why we have embarked on the joint working group that has representation from Scottish Parliament, government, and very well respected external witnesses and participants as well, of course.
Kezia Dugdale.
Thank you. I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary would take an early opportunity to explain to Parliament just exactly what he will publish between today and the 15th of December to allow Parliament to do its job.
Derek Mackay.
So I will do that, and appreciate that intervention, because what I've heard from members is a view that this isn't about drafting, publishing a draft budget, but a request to publish more information to take forward the debate we've had at the Finance Committee. So I was able to repeat my offer that I'm happy to provide the committee with additional strategic information to assist committees in preparing for the autumn statement and draft budget. And I'll commit to producing that information by the end of the October recess. Now, I have been grateful for the interventions and comments of other members. And in that information, I've outlined in previous correspondence what I think would be helpful for Parliament to consider around current spending, around the outcomes focus, and other areas. But I will include a set of high-level analysis of the Scottish Government's financial position and how possible UK tax and spending scenarios arising from the autumn statement will impact on our available resources. Now, that's what members have repeatedly told me they are looking for, and I will provide that within that timescale that has been requested. I'd like to make some further comments, if I may. And the reason for doing this properly is I think it is really important to produce credible information, not just to produce something for the sake of it, but something that is incredibly accurate, so that we are scrutinising the Parliament's, using the Parliament's function to scrutinise a credible budget. And Kate Forbes is absolutely right. It isn't just about the length of time, but the quality of scrutiny as well, and what is being scrutinised being robust and accurate and close to those forecasts, from the OBR to the autumn statement, and of course the work of the Scottish Fiscal Commission. And we will allow those statutory duties to bed in before we look further at that role. In terms of the question around the three-year spending review, we're 1 year into that, so there'll be 2 years remaining. And past this one-year budget, I've already said publicly that I would look at a multi-year spending review, but that's after this 1 year. That doesn't set a precedent. And also that joint working group will look at the entire process and that constructive way and then produce recommendations by next summer, and that can inform the future way we do business. And I don't say that this sets a precedent, but we are in unprecedented times in terms of the uncertainty that we face with the increased complexity that's now in place in terms of Scotland's budget. So I hope that the recognition that it's not just Derek Mackay and the Scottish Government, the Northern Ireland Executive have taken the same view on that level of uncertainty, and that's informed their position to defer the budget, not even till later in the year, but into next year. And I've set out a timescale that I said I would keep to around 3 weeks post-Chancellor's autumn statement. And I absolutely will hold true to that, having outlined a budget date and having made the commitment to give as much information as possible repeatedly to the Finance Committee and again within Parliament. And I do think that that information should be sufficient to address a number of concerns that have been raised.
Patrick Harvey.
I'm grateful. One last chance, because the Cabinet Secretary keeps using the same language as he used in the letter that the committee has described as unacceptable. Will he publish as much information as he can about the spending plans that the Scottish Government is considering in the wake of the impact, or is he only going to publish information about what he thinks the impact is going to be?
Derek Mackay.
I think I've been quite clear that what Parliament asked for was high-level scenario planning, and that's what I've said I'll provide within that timescale. I'm happy to write to the Finance Committee, and of course Mr. Harvey will take a great interest in that, but I've repeatedly said I won't publish a draft budget. I can't publish a credible draft budget or a number of draft budgets, but I will publish that scenario information that I've pledged to in keeping with what I've said to committee. And of course, to take this forward in a mature and rational way, because as we embark on using these new powers to the Scottish Parliament, I think it is important that we do it in a credible and robust way. And that does, of course, involve proper parliamentary scrutiny. But that process should be sound, Presiding Officer.
I now call on Alex Johnson to wind up the debate on behalf of the Finance and Constitution Committee. Around 8 minutes, please, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. This has been a worthwhile debate, which has been useful in highlighting some of the challenges which this Parliament faces in revising their processes following the devolution of significant new powers. Before I comment on some of the contributions we've heard this afternoon, I want to briefly focus on two issues. First, I want to make comment on the need for some level of scenario planning to be published to support parliamentary scrutiny in advance of publication of the draft budget. Secondly, I will briefly return to some of the complexities of this challenge, which the convener mentioned in his thoughtful opening speech. On the issue of scenario planning, Finance Committee members made it quite clear at our meeting on the 7th of September that in agreeing to a draft budget being published after the UK autumn statement, that there would be need for some level of scenario planning to be provided prior to that. The Cabinet Secretary responded, and I quote, "I am willing to produce as much scenario planning information as I can." The committee therefore finds it unacceptable that the Cabinet Secretary then went on to suggest that he is not in a position to publish any such scenario planning. We have, of course, during the Minister's closing remarks, heard a further extension of this form of words. Unfortunately, I believe it will take some further time to work out exactly what has been offered and what the outcome of that is likely to be. The committee considers, however, that without such information, it's unlikely that there will be sufficient opportunity for the subject committees to scrutinise the government's spending proposals. Presiding Officer, if I may now briefly turn to how we address the complexities of the budget process in future years. As we've heard, the Budget Process Review Group will have the unenviable task of unravelling these complexities and designing a new process which meets the government's emphasis on accuracy and the Parliament's emphasis on robust scrutiny. This, I am sure, will involve a number of trade-offs and in all probability an element of compromise on all sides. There are a number of issues which the committee has raised with the Scottish Government and which the review group is likely to consider. First, data sharing. The fiscal framework makes clear that both the Scottish Government and the Scottish Fiscal Commission should, and I quote, have access to the necessary data, information and models held by the UK Government to support policy development and produce forecasts of a comparable quality to those produced by the OBR. This raises issues of both timing and transparency. It is essential that data is made available timeously in order to maximise the time available for parliamentary scrutiny, and that this data is published while recognising the need for taxpayer confidentiality. Secondly, the levels of budget information are crucial. One of the benefits of budget scrutiny is that it has led to much greater levels of transparency in the level of budgetary information provided by the Scottish Government. The level of information which is provided regarding the operation of the fiscal framework will be vitally important in ensuring effective scrutiny, especially in relation to the calculation of the adjustments to the block grant, the methodology and assumptions used to calculate forecast tax receipts, the reconciliation process, and the use of the new borrowing powers, including the operation of the Scotland Reserve. Third, timing of the publication of the draft budget. The committee has indicated that the reasons set out by the Cabinet Secretary's letter on the 23rd of June, which predates the EU referendum result, would not have been sufficient to justify delaying the publication of the draft budget until after the autumn statement. One of the key challenges of the budget review group will be identifying an optimum time for the publication of the draft budget, which can address both the relative accuracy of the numbers and the time available for scrutiny. Finally, the review of the budget process does offer a real opportunity to improve financial scrutiny. In particular, the committee is keen to develop the move towards a more outcomes-based approach to the budget scrutiny, which our predecessor committee began during the last session. This should involve much more scrutiny of the impact and effectiveness of how public bodies are spending public money before considering how it should be spent in future years. It should also result in an all-year-round approach to financial scrutiny and far better linkage between the audit and the budgetary functions. The committee has, however, made it clear that this new approach should not be viewed as a replacement for scrutiny of the draft budget document. As I come towards the end of my contribution, I think it's appropriate that I make some comment on some of the things that were said during the course of this debate. Some speakers, out of frustration, perhaps strayed into the area of discussing the budget itself. And with notification today that the budget publication is still some 10 weeks away, it's understandable that that frustration should have come about. Others, however, chose to demonstrate the level of tolerance which the Finance Committee has held for the Cabinet Secretary. Patrick Harvey in particular set out the fact that we have much to be concerned about in the committee and in this Parliament, but in the very simplest terms, the committee has offered a compromise to the Cabinet Secretary, and it appears, at the moment at least, that the Cabinet Secretary has not yet accepted that compromise. It is vital, therefore, as we go forward, to understand that if a compromise is possible, it must be reached quickly, because the worst possible outcome is for this standoff to continue to the point where the publication of the draft budget arrives on the 15th of December and we have made no progress in advance.
That concludes the debate on the timetable for the Scottish Government's draft budget 2017-18. And it's now time to move on to the next item of business.